Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
So let's see. We all know that quantum computing has taught us that quantum states are exponentially complex, right? What does it mean? So if you have a state of n particles, so if you want to describe the state of n particles and it's a classical system, then you need only order n parameters, like position and momentum of each particle. But quantumly, you need exponentially many parameters. Okay, so and of course, this has lots of important consequences computationally, quantum factoring, various other things. But what I want to talk about today is what are the implications of this for quantum mechanics? So, you know, surely if we are saying that quantum mechanics is this strange, then this ought to have consequences. So let's look at some consequences. So here are three questions about quantum mechanics that certainly you'd like to understand the answer to, and without understanding them, it's not clear that you could say, well, you really understand quantum mechanics. So the first question is, so even though quantum systems are exponentially complex, exponentially powerful, there's still a lot of physics that's done. So, people actually understand these systems. So now, can we understand what are these quantum states that you can actually describe efficiently? So why is it that you can do quantum mechanics? So could it be that typical quantum systems don't have this exponential complexity, and so you could actually simulate them efficiently? Another question you could ask is, what happens if you have this quantum system at high temperature or room temperature? Does this exponential complexity go away? Could it be for some reason that such systems become simple? Or could they still have exponential complexity? And then the third question you could ask is, well, if there's this exponential complexity and you really can't even calculate what these quantum systems do, then in what sense can you actually do science on them? So, you could have a theory, but if you can't even tell what it predicts, if it's not falsifiable, then how do you actually work with it? Okay, I want to argue that to actually study these questions, you have to look at them computationally, and that if you look at them computationally, you can make progress on them. Okay, so let's start with the first question. So, how hard are typical quantum systems? So what we want to understand is, could it be that naturally occurring quantum systems, whatever these are actually easy, and that you have to work really hard, and that to build a quantum computer, it's something that something strange that you have to do, but mostly quantum mechanics is easy. Okay, so why do you want to do this? Well, first, because you want to do quantum simulations of quantum systems. But also, you can ask fundamentally, how much of physics can you really understand by classical means? Okay, so here's the sort of systems I'll be looking at. So I'll assume that we have a lattice of particles, and that when we talk about quantum states, in reality, you can't just create arbitrary quantum states, unless you're trying to build a quantum computer. You really look at what kind of interactions there are between particles, and then what kind of quantum states result from those interactions. So how do you describe these interactions? So let's assume that your particles are sitting in nicely in a lattice, a 2D or 3D lattice, and then they are interacting somehow according to the local structure. And so you have local interactions between two or three particles, whatever. And so these local interactions are described by what's called a Hamiltonian. And then you know, there's this entire area of condensed matter physics that studies systems like this, where what you want to understand is what are the ground states or low energy states of such a system. And once you understand these describe the properties of materials. Okay, so let's look at this a little more closely. So each term of this Hamiltonian, which is sort of a local interaction, assigns to a state of the quantum system an energy penalty, which says, you know, is it high or low energy, is it one or zero? And then the total energy of this state is the sum of these energy penalties. And so now, of course, different states will have different energy, and so we are looking for the state which has the lowest energy, and that's the ground state. Okay. Now, this should look very familiar to you, even if you don't do quantum computation, because there's an analogy between local Hamiltonians and constraint satisfaction problems. Because in a constraint satisfaction problem, you have a bunch of variables, let's say Boolean variables, or you know, over some finite alphabet, and these variables are we have local constraints on them, and what we are trying to do is understand how many of these local constraints we can simultaneously satisfy. What's the minimum number of unsatisfied clauses or constraints of this kind? So the analogy with that is that the Hamiltonian of the system is a sum of local terms, each of which provides a constraint on those particles, and it assigns an energy penalty which you can think of as saying that constraint was not satisfied. And so the higher the energy, the fewer constraints are satisfied. And so when you're looking for a ground state, you're looking for a state which satisfies as many of those constraints as possible. Right? So you could say that the local Hamiltonian problem is a generalization of the constraint satisfaction problem. Although physicists might disagree with that, they might say that actually the constraint satisfaction problem is a special case of the local Hamiltonian problem, because that came first. Okay, so let me just describe this in a little more, Okay. So let me show you how you can think of 3SAT as a local Hamiltonian problem. So your bits will now correspond to qubits in the quantum setting. And if you have a clause of this form, either xi, x1 or x2 or x3 is true, then this will correspond to an 8x8 Hamiltonian matrix, right? Because there are 8 possible assignments, so it's 8-dimensional space. And then this Hamiltonian will actually be diagonal, because and of these 8 assignments, only the assignment zeros. Only the assignment 000 fails to satisfy it, and so you assign an energy penalty of 1 for that case and 0 otherwise, right? And of course, so to say what this clause corresponds to, you'll it corresponds to this Hamiltonian on these 3 qubits, and the identity on everything else. So the corresponding term would be this tensor, the identity. And then you add together these matrices, which are all 2^n by 2^n matrices. And your satisfying assignment would be an eigenvector with eigenvalue 0 for that corresponding Hamiltonian. And in fact, because all these are diagonal, every truth assignment is an eigenvector with eigenvalue equal to the number of unsatisfied clauses. Okay, so that's the correspondence between local Hamiltonians and constraint satisfaction problems. Except, of course, that in the local Hamiltonian problem, these need not be diagonal, right? So each of these local terms might be diagonalized in a different basis, and this adds an added level of complexity to the problem.
Just out of curiosity, so the concept of locality is also well held in physics, or is that something that's more...
Oh, locality we derive from physics, yes. That it's very basic to physics.
Well, there's two senses of locality that get conflated, right? There's spatial locality, and then there's locality of you only each term only involves two or three particles.
Right.
I think
and both. Both of them. you really set that up, didn't you? Okay, so, and then just as, finding the minimum, a satisfying assignment is NP complete, the corresponding problem of finding the ground state energy is QMA complete. So it's a quantum analog of NP. And in fact, it remains QMA complete. This problem of finding the ground energy remains hard even if you look at very simple systems. So the simplest of these is these one-dimensional Hamiltonians, which are translationally invariant. So what does this mean? It means that you have a chain of particles in one dimension, and they are interacting with nearest neighbor interactions. And moreover, the interaction is the same for every pair. So it's the same interaction between these as these as these. So the input to the problem is of constant size. So you'd wonder how this could be hard. Well, the input to the problem is that local term plus the length of the chain. And so it's hard because the problem instance is of size n. N is part of the input. And now the hardness assumption is the exp version of QMA. So what do all these completeness results tell us? So what they tell us is that if, as we believe, NP is not equal to QMA, then we don't even expect to have a polynomial size description of these ground states. We actually expect the smallest description to be exponential size. Okay?
This corresponding to saying here there was a small description of satisfying assignments.
Right. Okay. And now, of course, on this side we have the famous PCP theorem that it's NP hard to approximate the minimum number of unsat clauses. And you could ask, well, is a quantum version of it also true? Could it be that it's actually QMA hard even to approximate the ground energy? Now, if this were true, then what this would tell us is that, in fact, even if you were to sample from the Gibbs distribution at a reasonably high temperature, you'd be able to tell from the state that you sampled whether this energy was small or large, whether the ground energy was small or large, and you'd be solving a QMA hard problem. So that would show that, in fact, if you could have this notion of temperature for quantum systems that was, for this kind of quantum system, then even at high temperature, the state is hard to sample.
Well, wait a minute, would we have any reason to think that nature would actually get into that state?
No, not necessarily, but that's why I said if you have a notion of, so if you can sample from something, if you can cool it down to that temperature, or if you can create that kind of state, then it's fine.
Yeah,
what? What's temperature? Okay, so what? Oh, right. Sorry. Yeah. Maybe I should make a blanket warning and apology. I'll try to make this talk as, generally comprehensible as possible. But every so often, I'll say something like that, and either interrupt me or. So temperature is. So depending upon the temperature. So at very low temperatures, the system has to be in the ground state. But as you increase the temperature, it might, there's a distribution over states depending upon, and you can get to higher and higher energy states. And so the actual distribution is given by some Gibbs distribution, which is, some function of the energy and the temperature. So
So does it correspond to like the location of the gap in the PCP? Where, you know, you have a three set where you already see that it's 80% unsatisfiable.
So I think the analog is that if you're trying to come up with a constraint, if you have a satisfiability instance and you pick assignments with probability, say, exponentially small in the number of unsatisfied clauses. Okay. And the question is, what's the constant in front of the exponent? That's the temperature, right?
Okay. So what do we know about, we know that the PCP theorem is true. In fact, we know it because several of the authors of the proofs are here in this audience. So how, why can't we just either carry out that proof or at least outsource it to them, to Madhu and Irith, and be done with it? So there are a few problems with the quantum case. You know, one of them is there's this really, depending upon your point of view, either a wonderful thing or a very irritating theorem called the no-cloning theorem, which says that quantum information cannot be cloned. You cannot copy quantum information. Okay, so if you have an unknown quantum state, you cannot create a perfect copy of it, or even an imperfect copy of it. Right? So it turns out this quantum PCP theorem is a well-balanced theorem in the sense that we don't know whether it should be true or false. Okay, well, what do we know about it? So a few years ago, we tried to see if we could, I guess that was when Irith's proof had just come out a couple of years before, and we were trying to see if we could sort of leverage that proof into somehow working in this quantum case. And there are three main steps in that proof, and we were able to take the very simplest of them and use a lot of work to prove it in the quantum case. Okay. Now the other thing one can do is we can, as in the standard PCP theorem, you can define it either in terms of proof checking, or you can define it in terms of this the gap, for constraint satisfaction, or in this case Hamiltonians, and you can show that the two definitions are equivalent. So in the classical case, this is very easy. In the quantum case, it actually takes work to show that they're equivalent. And then very recently, also, the classical PCP theorem requires some sort of notion of expanders, underlying the proof. And I guess until very recently, Matt Hastings was a bit of a skeptic about the PCP theorem. And recently, he thought that there was a certain structure that had to hold, which is not just the quantum expander, but some enhanced version of it. And he didn't think that this could possibly exist. And so recently, with Mike Friedman, he showed that, in fact, you can construct these special kinds of quantum expanders. So now he's cautiously optimistic, or maybe the accurate thing is not as pessimistic. But that still leaves us with a very well-balanced question where we don't know what the answer should be. And this is, I think, a very basic open question in the field. Okay, so let's move back to the first question again, where we started, which is, can we understand and simulate typical quantum systems? So, we tried to do that by saying, well, we want to simulate what it means to simulate or represent states efficiently is ground states of local Hamiltonians. But Kitaev's theorem and its refinements show us that that's not going to be possible. So now what do we do? So then the thing you can notice is that these QMA complete problems have a certain property, which is that the Hamiltonians have a 1 over poly n spectral gap, meaning that the ground energy and the next higher energy, the difference between them is 1 over polynomial in n. Right. On the other hand, natural Hamiltonians, there are many natural Hamiltonians have this property that the spectral gap is a constant. Okay. So let me say what this means. Okay, so to say that the spectral gap is a constant, we have to have the right normalization. So let me assume that each term of the Hamiltonian assigns an energy penalty of 1. Right? So it's like 3SAT, where each clause is counted as one constraint. And then what it means to say that that there's a constant gap means, so let's say that the ground state has energy 0, so it satisfies all the terms of the Hamiltonian, then the next excited state has a property that it violates, say, one of the terms, or it violates 1/10 of a term of the Hamiltonian.
So I'm not sure I understand these gaps. So there's like the ground state, which is low temperature, and then you have some kind of temperature 1, temperature 2.
No. So there's a ground state which has eigenvalue 0. Let's say that's its the energy is given by it's given by the Hamiltonian, right? The Hamiltonian is the energy function. The states of definite energy are the eigenstates of this Hamiltonian, right? The ground state is that eigenvector with lowest eigenvalue, and that eigenvalue is the energy of that state. Mm-hmm. Now you look at the next eigenvector with the next higher energy.
Oh.
And look at the difference between that energy and the ground energy. It's that gap.
Right?
Thanks. So now we could ask, could it be that ground states of gap local Hamiltonians are simple, that they have nice, simple descriptions, polynomial size, et cetera? And the answer depends upon how much entanglement these states have, right? So what is entanglement? Well, it's this property. So say you have a quantum state on n qubits, and now you partition it into two parts, into n over 2 particles and n over 2 particles here, a and b. And now you ask, what's the state of A and what's the state of B? Well, quantumly, you can't always ask this question, because the state is a superposition, which you can think of as some sort of a probability distribution, except with negative probabilities. And so now, if you have a probability distribution on this space on n bits, okay, and now you ask, what's the probability distribution on the first n over 2? Well, if the probability distribution, if there are correlations between the left and the right, then you cannot say, right? And the amount of correlations between the left and the right determines how big your description of this probability distribution will be. In general, it'll be exponentially large if these correlations are very large. So in the quantum case, we call these correlations entanglement, and that's what's going to determine how big the description is. Okay, so let me just say a little bit about entanglement, just to give you a flavor of. So here's an example of an entangled state of two qubits. Where the two qubits are either in the state 0, 0 with probability with amplitude 1/√2, and in the state 1, 1 with amplitude 1/√2. So now, if you ask what's the state of the first qubit, well, it's either 0 or 1, but you cannot quite say, right? Because it's entangled with the other side. So, but if you measure the first qubit, you see a random outcome, 0 or 1. And then if you measure the other qubit, you get a correlated outcome. You actually get the same outcome as in the first case. And this is a way of achieving stronger correlations than you can achieve classically. So that's entanglement of two qubits. Now, if you have n qubits, then you could create even more entanglement by just looking at a state like this, a cat state, which is in a superposition where the left half is in the state I and the right half is in the state I. Right? So they are completely correlated, and then this particular state has amplitude c sub I, and you have a superposition over all I. Right? So this would be a highly entangled state of the n qubits. Now, in the general case, we might have a state of n qubits, and we split it up into k on the left, m on the right. And it turns out that the situation I described out here is the general situation, except that the correlation doesn't have to be in the basis states, in the classical states, I. It's just that there's going to be some basis for the left Hilbert space and some basis for the right Hilbert space, so that you have perfect correlation between the ith basis vector on the left and the ith basis vector on the right, with amplitude c sub I, and you know that's what your superposition looks like.
So these AIs are vectors in some
two to the k dimensional space on this side and two to the m on that side.
And they're orthogonal.
They're orthogonal, and then you're picking up corresponding ones to create this state. It's perfectly correlated in this way.
And this is any general state.
This is any state can be written this way. This is just a singular value decomposition. It's called the Schmidt decomposition. I don't know which came first. Okay, and so now the Schmidt rank or the entanglement rank of this state is just the number of non-zero i's, non-zero ci's. Right. So the Schmidt rank is one if and only if it's a product state, where each side is defined by itself, and it's in a tensor product state. Now you can also look at a more refined notion of measure of entanglement, where you look at not just the number of non-zeros but also the quantity, the magnitude of these c sub i's, and so you can look. It's called the von Neumann entropy of this state across this partition, and it's just the classical entropy of the ci squares. Okay. And so if many of the ci's are small, then the von Neumann entropy can be very small, even if the Schmidt rank is large. Okay, so now remember what we wanted to do was we wanted to see how much entanglement is there in the ground state of a local gap local Hamiltonian. So it turns out that there's this beautiful conjecture. It's called an area law. Okay, so what it says is that if you look at the ground state, so these are all the particles that we are working with. And now take the particles and partition them into two sets in an arbitrary way. Okay, and let's look at the ground state of this local Hamiltonian and look at how much entanglement there is between this region and the other region, between the inside and the outside of this shape.
So how did you quantify entanglement? Did you already do it?
So we quantify it by either the Schmidt rank or by the von Neumann entropy. And we'll use the von Neumann entropy, actually. That's the correct notion. Okay, so you take this, the system, you partition it into two parts. Now look at the ground state across this partition and ask how much entanglement is there between these two parts in the ground state. And what the area law says is that this entanglement, which could be, whether it could be as large as the volume, as the number of particles inside this system, it actually ends up being only as large as the surface area of this region. Okay, that's what the area law said. Now, okay, let me. I should do a bit of translation for you. When physicists call something a law, we would call it a conjecture. Okay. So, okay, but.
What we call a theorem?
they call that madness, or they call that unnecessary work. the thought behind the area law is that the entanglement, most of the entanglement, just sits at the surface, right? It's very local. There isn't much long-range entanglement at all in these ground states. And so now you can see why this would allow you to describe these states efficiently. Because what you want to do is, ideally what you want to do is you want to say, to describe the state of this system, I'll describe the inside and I'll describe the outside, and what else is there to describe? And that's it, right? But that's not thinking about it quantumly, right? Quantumly, there's entanglement. You think about this as describing, it's like describing a probability distribution on this space. And so you describe, what you want to do is you want to describe the inside, describe the outside, and you want to describe some correction to get all the correlations. But now if the correlations are very local, you have a hope of being able to do this in an efficient way. And in fact, there are these beautiful structures called tensor networks, which allow you to do this. But then the size of this tensor network depends upon how much entanglement there is and how it's distributed.
You never have long-range correlations in these.
So the area law would say that you typically, you know, that the long-range correlations are either not there or they're very small. You know, so you could closely approximate the state by ignoring them.
So if we came up with a particular state like I on the left and I on the right, and the uniform superposition over all I's, can we rule that out?
Yeah, so you know, you wouldn't find a local Hamiltonian, a gap local Hamiltonian that describes that.
So for that particular state, can we prove the area law? I mean,
I see.
All right, okay.
I'm sure it's that shouldn't be hard to show, but.
Well, the area law has been proved for one-dimensional gapped Hamiltonians.
Okay, I see. Okay, or maybe one-dimensional frustration-free gapped Hamiltonians.
Yes.
So in this picture, where do you see the, where is the gap?
Where's the gap in all this?
Where's the gap Hamiltonian here?
Showing up? Yeah. Oh, the gapped Hamiltonian, you know, so that's all not in the picture that I showed you, you know. So there's a gapped Hamiltonian, we have a ground state of it. It's a state of these particles. Right, and now we are looking at that quantum state, right? It's an object. It's a unit vector in a 2 to the n dimensional Hilbert space, where these are the n particles, and then we are partitioning these particles into two subsets, and then we are looking at that state of these n particles and asking how much entanglement is there across this.
But the HIs are supposed to be local in this picture, right?
The HIs are local. That's what these are.
But aren't they always local? I mean, even in the theorem you showed us this computation on one line.
Yeah.
Being
human. Yeah, that was also local. Yeah, yeah. No. So physics requires.
Very high entanglement in this.
Oh thing. Right. Yeah. So but the difference is. No. Exactly. So. Once you have a QMA completeness proof, you're actually saying you can build up a lot of entanglement there.
So, but
there you didn't have a gap, right? So it was the gap was inverse polynomial. Now we are hoping that the fact that the gap is constant here will allow us to prove this.
And there's the spatial structure.
Yeah. But the spatial structure is there in the QMA.
Yeah. You can also do that one.
Yeah.
So you do have, in other words, you do have examples of this. Spatial structure, just like in this picture, where there is known to be no.
That's right.
No area law.
Yeah.
But it doesn't have a constant gap.
That's right. Yeah. Okay, so this, you know, the area law is, you know, it has its origins in this principle from cosmology, the holographic principle, which sort of says that. You know, the information in a black hole is, the amount of information you can pack into a black hole is proportional to its surface area rather than its volume. And then since that a black hole is assumed to have the highest concentration of information per unit of space, this sort of says the amount of information you can pack into a unit of space depends on the surface rather than the volume. And so this particular version of the area law, so it was sort of, you know, it was folklore and understood in various ways for many, you know, many years. And then it was not until about 10, 12 years ago, using, concepts from quantum information, that this was made precise in this sense. So the precise version of the area law only goes back to about 2000, 2001. Yeah.
Still, I mean, I guess how the gap, comes into the area law is there an intuition? Like, do we have reasons to believe that the gap would help?
There are reasons to believe it, but I won't get into. Maybe I'll show you a little bit later and how it comes about. But there are various reasons that this is.
I see the connection to the holographic principle, right? Because holographic principle would say even if you can go inside and measure all of the entropy that's in the interior, then it's still
empty. Yeah. So we don't know how physicists derive their intuition. So I'll take the fifth one. Okay. So about 5 years ago, Matt Hastings gave a rigorous proof of the area law for 1D systems. And this was really a tour de force. It was quite a remarkable proof. It was so remarkable that many of us couldn't even understand it. So what the area law for 1D systems shows is what it says is that if you cut the line in some place, then the entanglement across it is proportional to the surface area, which in this case is 1, and so it's a constant. Okay, so the only question is how big is this constant, and what Matt showed. So the constant is a function of two things. One is the dimension of each particle. So if it's a qubit, it's two-dimensional, or if it's a qutrit, it's three-dimensional. So let's say it's a d-dimensional particle, and then the spectral gap is epsilon. So the main question is how does it scale with log d over epsilon? And so what Matt showed is that it scales at worst as an exponential in log d over epsilon. So one consequence of it is that 1D ground states, this lies in NP rather than being QMA complete. Right? So this was already a very important consequence. So then there was a sequence of results that, where we studied this from a more combinatorial computer science perspective, and we were able to eventually improve this bound to something like big O of, well, it should be O twiddle of log cube d over epsilon. Okay, so
over epsilon inside the log?
No, it's outside. So it's right. And what this has, if you look, the detailed result has a few consequences. One of them is that you actually get a sub exponential time algorithm for finding the ground state
of a gapped
1D Hamiltonian. The other thing it shows is that, if you could improve this bound from log cube to log, then it would imply the area law for any number of dimensions, because you can just fuse all the particles near the surface into a superparticle, and then you could peel off one layer at a time to get a 1D system. But that's a bit wasteful. So if you use the locality a little further, then effectively you can reduce this exponent as though it was 2, right? Using that locality. And so basically, if we can improve this, cut this down, this exponent down by 1 more, then we could scale the area law. Or if you could cut it down by even a small amount, then we'd get a subvolume law for 2D. Systems. Yeah.
Sub-exponential time algorithm is a classical algorithm?
It's a classical algorithm which outputs a tensor network.
There's no reason, I don't necessarily follow the definitions carefully, so even finding a BQP, a quantum polynomial time algorithm for this may be feasible and interesting, right? I mean, it's not given that this problem has a BQP.
That's right.
Does an area law say something like you can come up with more efficient algorithms for time-evolving Hamiltonian, a gapped Hamiltonian?
So that's the other question one could ask, is not just can you find the ground state, but can you now simulate in the neighborhood of that state? And all these are interesting questions. And I think you can also sort of ask, well, can you use the adiabatic algorithm to find these ground states quickly? This sort of thing. These are all interesting questions, and the answers. Well, there are some answers known, but not all of them. There are some very promising proposals for simulating 2D systems using tensor networks. And some actual successes in doing this for particular systems, and at least or beginnings of successes in that. But if one can carry this program out to completion, you know, to actually simulating 2D systems efficiently, you know, systems of interest, this would be quite a revolutionary, you know, development in condensed matter physics. And, you know, there's a lot of potential for algorithmic ideas here. Okay, so let me move on to the third vignette, and then, okay, so if there's time, I'll give you a sketch of this proof, but you know, we can also make that. I don't know how I'm doing on time, but
about 25 minutes. Or so.
Okay, 25 minutes, meaning that okay, so there's a chance I might be able to fit it in. Let's see. Okay. So here's the third vignette. It had to do with how do you test, you know, how do you do science on, you know, on in a quantum world, right? So there are many sorts of questions you can ask. So first, you can ask the very specific question. So, you know, let's say that, you know, you want to do science the way it's supposed to be done, which is, you know, you never believe a theory. You just believe that we haven't disproved it yet, right? That's how we are supposed to do science. And moreover, the thing we are supposed to do is take those aspects of the theory that we find most incredible, you know, most counterintuitive, and put our maximum effort in testing those. So, this is what physics does. You know, you always test a theory in the limit of, you know, in some limit of high energy or small size or high velocity. And so, you know, what quantum computing suggests is that you should be testing physics also in the limit of high complexity, because this is, you know, probably the most counterintuitive aspect of quantum mechanics. And until we do that, we shouldn't, you know, we shouldn't even say, you know, of course, we are never supposed to say we believe the theory, but, you know, have we even been given a proper opportunity to not disbelieve it? So what do you do in, you know, when you make such tests? What you're supposed to do is set up some experiment, then predict calculate what the theory says you will see, and then run the experiment and test and see whether what you got as your outcome is within some error bars of what was predicted. So now, you know, with quantum computation, with quantum mechanics, there's a problem with this prescription. How do you predict what you're supposed to see? Now, of course, there's one thing you can do, which is you can run Shor's algorithm. You can try to if you build a quantum computer, you take your number, you run the algorithm, you look at the outputs, which you didn't predict, but now you can do some post-processing on these outputs, and you can multiply them together and see if you got back the number you started with. So already that's a small deviation from this method.
But, well, if you have a quantum computer, you can use the quantum computer to predict the outcome of the experiment.
Right.
Then what you're doing is you're comparing.
Right. So
for consistency.
Except what if you don't believe quantum mechanics yet?
Well, I mean, this is a incredibly precise consistency test for quantum mechanics. The results of a quantum computer predict the quantum experiment.
I mean, they're both being classical inside.
Yeah, I mean, but they're, you know, these are completely different experiments, and this is a incredibly powerful consistency test.
Well, okay. We'd have to.
Lean at Levin would say something about like two crooks who agree with each other.
Yeah. Okay. So here's a different approach to this problem. So what you might want to do is Okay, so instead, let's think of the following scenario. So we have a classical experimentalist who wishes to verify that the outcome of the quantum experiment is exactly what quantum mechanics predicted. So, of course, we can always formulate this as checking that a certain quantum computation gives a particular output. Right? Okay. So now we could turn to, you know, our favorite conceptual framework of interactive proofs, where we have the experimentalist sitting here who's very limited in terms of computational power. But then you have nature, which is supposed to be quantum. And so it can perform these remarkable computations efficiently. So why not have the experimentalist interact with nature to get a proof that the outcome of this quantum computation is what it should be? Okay, so, and of course, if you could do this, then the proof of correctness of this protocol would tell you, you know, that together with the proof of correctness, the fact that this interactive protocol ran to completion correctly would convince Arthur that if he were to actually figure out, you know, if he were to actually calculate what the outcome of that experiment would be according to quantum mechanics, and then run that experiment and look at the outcome of that experiment, the two would check. Right? So this would be a proof that in fact, if he ran this experiment, you know, if he did this, if he were capable of running this experiment and computing what should be the output, then the two would be the same. Okay, so this is the scenario that we want. We are substituting quantum mechanics in the place of Merlin, and we want to carry out this interactive proof. Now, of course, the problem here is that the prover is no longer unbounded computing power, right? The prover only has as much power as quantum mechanics, so it's BQP, quantum polynomial time. And so the question is, can a quantum polynomial time prover convince a classical verifier about any language in BQP? Okay, and so this is an open question. So the question is, do quantum prover interactive proofs have the same power as BQP? There are two kinds of partial progress. So there's this work by Aronov et al. And Rob Bend et al., which sort of looked at this model where Arthur, in addition to being polynomial time, has a constant number of qubits of storage.
So what's wrong for practical purposes building some quantum computer that factors big numbers?
Well, let's say that you wanted to verify not factoring, but you wanted to verify some other aspect of quantum mechanics. Right? So you know, when you do classical physics, there are all kinds of questions you want to know the answer to, and you do many experiments. So let's say that you wanted to do some experiment in quantum mechanics, right? Which is not factoring; it's some other experiment, and you want to know that. You know, you want to do what physicists like to do, which is understand that nature behaves according to the theory.
At least deal with the six.
Sure. No. So now we are okay. So I'm asking the question: Can you verify every aspect of quantum mechanics? Right. And what this is saying is, okay, if it was true that you had such interactive proofs, then you could verify every aspect. Right. Okay. So we don't know the answer to this. So there are a couple of different scenarios, which are variants of this, where one can say that you have such interactive proofs. One is where Arthur, in addition to his polynomial time computing power, has a constant number of qubits of storage that he can work with, and a quantum channel to Merlin. So he can prepare quantum states on a small number of qubits and ship them off to Merlin in the course of this.
The storage isn't needed in the broadband Fitzsimmons-Kashifi. That just
actually. Yeah, but the that one has the problem that it's not clear that it's the proof works. So.
So you're just.
I'm sorry.
The things cancel out.
I'm sorry. No. I mean, so I
off, yeah. So any so. Number of parameters for soundness.
So. Okay. But we don't know. I mean, it's not yet, clear what's going on with that. But okay. So, and then there's a different model in which we can do this, where you have two non-communicating Merlins. Okay. So in this first case, you know, these results are based on quantum authentication schemes, whereas this one is based on something very different we were doing, which was the rigidity of CHSH game. So,
so I have a question. In this two non-communicating Merlins, so Arthur's classical, he asks questions, he gets back, and all you know, they're not communicating, but they share quantum bits.
Right.
Quantum tangle state. But and another question. What is the power of, what do we know about BQP?
Sorry. How powerful is it?
Yeah. Where does it lie in the,
It's sort of a strange class. It's it obviously contains BPP. It's contained in sharp P.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Right. And in terms of complexity theory, we don't know very much else except that we believe it's, you know, we believe it cuts across, so that it doesn't contain NP, but it's also not contained in the hierarchy, the polynomial hierarchy. So it's some new class in some new direction.
So when Reinhardt and Unger and Lazzarani, you're assuming that you believe relativity because you're assuming that these guys cannot communicate.
Oh, yeah.
So
yes.
You believe relativity, but you are completely skeptical of quantum mechanics.
Yeah, so
physical model of the universe.
Well, so for example,
quantum mechanics, why should you believe in relativity?
So, you know, we have precedent there. Einstein believed in relativity, but not quantum mechanics.
You mentioned that these Merlins have to be entangled.
Yeah.
I would have thought that an absence of entanglement would have made things even more powerful. That entanglement is something that one should worry about, as Arthur should worry about.
Well, yeah, you know, it cuts both ways. So the absence of entanglement is powerful in some cases. It can be very powerful, but also entanglement itself is a powerful resource. It's not clear how you would prove an absence of entanglement. You know, although
prove non-communicating if separate than by the speed of light.
Let's say, for example.
So is this MIP star with two provers?
Actually, yeah. So what it shows is that. I don't know what's the MIP star equal to QMIP star equal to QMIP or something. It's that, so you can show that if you have two entangled provers and quantum verify, you can also, you know, you can also make the verifier classical at the expense of adding a prover.
So I think MIP star is where you have a classical verifier and then entangled provers, right?
Yeah.
And then
yeah.
I guess Thomas's work says. If you have like five entangled provers, this contains NX.
Yeah.
So this is saying that there really is a difference between having two entangled provers.
No. These are provers, but they are weak provers. They are quantum provers, not unbounded power.
Okay.
So it's a different, it doesn't correspond to QIP at all. So I don't know. I can skip all this if.
5 or 10 minutes would be a good thing.
Yeah. How about this? You know, unless people positively have the stamina for this, let me skip it.
So you have the. Let me comment. So this frustration free, is that.
No. So okay. So here's okay. Let me say 2 minutes worth about it. So what I was going to do is. Sketch out the proof in the special case of frustration-free. And then actually many of the ideas for the general case are already in this case. And then you have to do some further work beyond this to get the general case.
Yeah. So
it's not limited to frustration.
No, it's not. Just, it's not.
Their slides are limited to frustration for you.
Right. Right.
Okay. Yeah. So, how about the following? I propose that we take, you have any concluding slides?
Yeah, I'll do that.
And then we have some time, so people who want to hear about the details.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Let me do that. Okay. So. Okay, so here's where we started from. So, so there were three questions about quantum systems that we started with. And each of these three questions can be written as a basic computational question, right? So the first one, whether at high temperature you can, quantum mechanics is still exponentially powerful. It's this question about quantum PCPs, right? Whether
this is really, really high temperature.
Yes.
I mean, there's also intermediate temperatures where you might be able to get something that's not as powerful as QPCP, but
sure.
Yeah.
Then there's this question about being able to simulate typical quantum systems, and that's related to this question of high-dimensional area laws, or what's the structure of solutions to the quantum analog of satisfiability, right? So, and then there's a question about can you actually extend the scientific method to quantum mechanics, to all of quantum mechanics, and that's this question about quantum. Interactive proofs with a BQP prover. What's the power of these interactive proofs? Okay. So now the interesting thing about this whole idea about looking through the computational lens is that a lens works two ways, right? So you can either look through it, or you can use, once you look through it, it also focuses things back. This, by the way, is a solar alarm clock. Okay, so the interesting thing is when you look outwards and you look at things outwards, you also get to focus in, and you get to ask. Actually, in this case, you get to ask very new questions which extend complexity theory in new directions. And then you have an additional advantage that, physicists are no slouches. They've been thinking about these for a long time, and they have really deep insights into them. And so you get to build upon those insights. Okay, so there's another way to look at it, which is, this idea about theory as a lens or computation as a lens, it's not such a new idea. In some sense, computer science has been doing it all along, or at least theory has been doing it all along. In fact, the most fundamental questions, which we consider the core of theory, actually, in some sense you can say they came from looking outside. So for example, NP, this came from not looking at computer science, but at logic, right? And algorithms, they have their origins, many of our algorithms have their origins in operations research. In fact, even the notion of polynomial time from, it was Jack Edmonds in operations research, and the notion of NP intersect co-NP is what he came up with as good characterizations.
Are logic and LR really outside of us?
Well, that's
right.
that's a
right.
Good question. Or with the PCP theorem, it was really looking, quite far from what we regarded as core complexity theory at that time in terms of, security, cryptography, and coding theory. And so in some sense, this notion that somehow we now have the core of theory defined, and that's what we should really think about is sort of as, it's going against the grain of the subject. And okay, so I'll stop.
Thanks. had to say something about physical insights, what's come to us? I mean, what are some theorems or techniques?
Well, so for example, if you just look at the area law, it's very much a, you know, a physical insight, and it's a pretty deep physical insight.
So insight in the sense of suggestive of potential theorems, or are you also saying there's
techniques,
methods by which?
Oh, definitely, they are definitely, yes. No, they are definitely, I would say much of this is builds upon, you know, you use techniques maybe in a new way, maybe in a more computer science, theoretical computer science way, but it's at every level.
So your proof is based on their intuition somehow?
Case. Some of it is, yeah. So at this point, you know, it looks very different from the previous proofs, but there are definitely insights from that were very useful.
Other questions? Okay, if not, let's.
So if you were considering the scenario of doing an experiment. Sort of variable quantum mechanics. So imagine you had some system that was that you knew the ground state, finding the ground state was a QMA-R problem.
Sorry.
So imagine you had some experimental system,
yeah.
Some simple Hamiltonian, and you knew that finding the ground state is a QMA-R problem. Then that system can only possibly have had 13.7 billion years to find itself into its ground state, and if it's sufficiently tough to get there, it just won't be in the ground state.
Yeah.
So one sort of physicist's response to this would be to say if typical systems are of very high complexity, the ground state no longer becomes a physically interesting thing to study,
right?
Because the real actual experimental system won't be in its ground state.
That's right.
And that would be fascinating, particularly.
Yeah, sure.
But then you have an even a harder question of what is the real dynamics of these physical systems
in
finite temperature?
Yeah.
Right.
Which
and everything would be kinetic. So
people can't answer that one either.
Right. And, you know, or you could say, how do you know that it didn't start out in this crazy ground state at the Big Bang? No,
my understanding is that's a pretty high temperature.
Right.
Okay. Other questions? Okay, let's thank Ramesh again.